This video covers how to interpret the results of the Kirby-Bauer test. In this example, the inhibition zone around the chloramphenicol disc is 28 millimeters. To interpret the results, the number is compared to a table. The table has a list of antibiotics and their concentrations, and it also lists the cutoff for each antibiotic. For example, in the case of erythromycin, the bacteria are resistant if the inhibition zone is less than 13 millimeters in diameter. The bacteria are susceptible if the inhibition zone is greater than 23 millimeters and intermediate in between those measurements. Note that the interpretation for ampicillin depends on which bacteria you use. There are two different sets of standards. One for when your bacteria are staphylococci and a separate set for all other bacteria. In our example, chloramphenicol has an inhibition zone of 28 millimeters, which is greater than 18 millimeters. These bacteria are therefore susceptible to chloramphenicol. Pause the video to determine the inhibition zones for kanamycin, ampicillin, streptomycin, and penicillin. Now use this table to interpret your measurements. I measured the inhibition zone as follows: kanamycin 22 mm, streptomycin 8 mm, ampicillin 14 mm, and for penicillin, there is no inhibition zone. Apparently, the bacteria can grow in the presence of penicillin, even at the highest concentration, right at the edge of the antibiotic disc. Based on the measurements and the interpretation tables, Serratia marcescens is susceptible to chloramphenicol and kanamycin, intermediately susceptible to ampicillin, and resistant to penicillin and streptomycin. Which antibiotic would you choose to treat a patient who has a burn wound infection with Serratia marcescens? If you had to choose between these antibiotics and the results of this Kirby-Bauer test, you would select chloramphenicol or kanamycin. Here is an example of a Kirby-Bauer test performed on the gram-negative bacillus Pseudomonas aeruginosa. Pause the video to determine the sizes and interpret with the table. Do these interpretations match your own? In general, gram-negative bacteria are more resistant to antibiotics than gram-positive bacteria. Pseudomonas aeruginosa in particular has many proteins in their membranes with which they pump antibiotics out of the cell, making them resistant. That does not necessarily mean that there are no antibiotics at all to treat the patients. However, available drugs may be more expensive and have more side effects. That may result in non-compliance, meaning that the patient stops taking the drug either because they cannot afford it or because the side effects are debilitating. If there are no antibiotics to which the pathogen is fully susceptible, it may be possible to use the maximum recommended dose of antibiotics to which the pathogen is intermediately susceptible. Alternatively, it may be possible to achieve a synergistic effect. Synergism is an effect of using two or more drugs with different modes of action at the same time. For example, one drug might inhibit transcription and the other translation, or one inhibits a metabolic pathway and the other inhibits transcription. The idea is that a bacteria may be able to withstand the presence of drug A or drug B separately, but not at the same time. And the combined effect of the two drugs is greater than their individual effects. In this animation, the bacteria are intermediately susceptible to drug A and B. However, if both drugs are administered together, the bacteria are fully susceptible. A medical professional also needs to consider whether a patient has allergies before prescribing a drug, even if the bacteria are susceptible to the drug. Potential side effects need to be weighed against the seriousness of the infection. And drug interactions between antibiotics and any other medical conditions the patient may have, or drugs they may be taken for other maladies, should be taken into account.